Hello everyone. I hope you're sitting quietly and are ready for our Elf space adventure. We are the National Schools Observatory, part of Liverpool John Moores University, and we are very excited to have you along for this epic journey across the universe. Just to let you know that we're recording this event, but only the presenters, so not you. But give us a big wave anyway. Teachers, we have a message for you too. Firstly, we have a Q&A feature in Teams, so feel free to use this throughout the event. Your questions will only be visible to us unless we publish and answer them, and we will try our very best to answer your questions throughout the event. Secondly, if for any reason you do get disconnected, you can rejoin using the same link. Thanks, teachers. So, children, students, aliens, and rogue elves, we have two really important things to tell you about today. Firstly, we will be giving you some instructions to follow during the event, which we hope you will listen to and join in along with. However, remember, your teacher is always boss, so always listen to what they say. And second, join in wherever possible and remember to have fun. So today we have got lots of students and schools joining us, and we've got over 7,000 people watching. So you are part of a huge group of wonderful space enthusiasts. So thank you very much for joining us. It is great to have you all here. Some of you may remember that last year we helped Santa plan his space vacation and he had a wonderful time. However, we recently received an urgent letter from Santa's elves requesting ours and your help. So let's see what the elves had to say.
Dear NSO, we need your help. When Santa travelled across space for his amazing holiday, some presents fell off the sleigh. We really need you to guide us through the universe so we can find them. We hope you can help us. Love, Santa's elves.
So, it seems we've got our work cut out for us today with lots of presents to find. And to help us track the presents, we've sent a map of the universe to your teachers. So as we travel across the universe, watch out for the presents. And when you do spot one, let your teacher know so we can keep count of them. And at the end, we'll compare maps to make sure that we found all of the presents. So we're almost ready to set off. So I hope you're all ready. But before we do set off, I'd like to get our minds warmed up with a great question from Lawrence Primary. And that question is, how big is the solar system in miles? So it is a great question. And it also depends on where you class the edge of the universe. Some scientists say it's where the sun's gravity stops having an effect, which reaches be�the furthest planet to the Oort cloud. But if we class the edge of the solar system as where the planets end, then the distance from the sun to Neptune is nearly 3,000 million miles. So that's 3 billion miles, which is huge. So thank you for your question, Lawrence Primary. It leads on perfectly to our first destination, our very own solar system with my friend David.
Solar system. Our solar system is made up of the sun, 8 planets, and lots of smaller objects. It is on an outer spiral arm of the Milky Way galaxy and is 4,500 million years old. The 4 planets closest to the sun are the inner solar system and are small rocky worlds. They are Mercury, Venus, the Earth, and Mars. All of them except Mercury have got an atmosphere and weather. The outer solar system is the name for the 4 larger, cooler planets that are made of gas and ice. These are called the giant planets, and they are the 2 gas giants, Jupiter and Saturn, along with the ice giants, Uranus and Neptune. Everything within the solar system is bound to the sun by gravity and orbits the sun. The distances involved are really, really huge. Mercury is the closest planet to the sun and is the smallest planet in the solar system. If you were standing on Mercury, the sun would look about 3 times bigger than it does on the Earth. Because Mercury is so small, it cannot hold on to an atmosphere, which means it is very hot on the side facing the sun, about 427 Celsius, and very cold on the side that faces away from the sun, around minus 173 Celsius. Venus is the second planet from the sun. It has a solid surface and is mainly made of rock. It is the 3rd smallest planet in the solar system, slightly smaller than the Earth. Venus has a thick atmosphere. This makes it the hottest planet in our solar system, even though Mercury is closer to the sun. The temperature on Venus can be as high as 462 Celsius. Earth is the 3rd planet from the sun. It is the largest rocky planet and is the only place that we know for certain that life exists in the universe. About 70% of the Earth is covered by liquid water, with the rest being land. The Earth turns on its axis as it orbits the Sun, and each of these turns takes 24 hours or one day. It takes 365 1/4 days to orbit the Sun, and we call this a year. The Earth has one large rocky satellite called the Moon. It is a natural satellite, meaning it is not man-made. It orbits the Earth every 27.3 days. The Moon pulling on water on the Earth is the reason that we experience tides. Mars is the last of the rocky planets. It is often called the red planet. This is because it is covered with a lot of iron oxide, which gives it its red colour. It is about half the diameter of Earth. Mars has huge dust storms, which can cover the entire planet and change how the surface looks. It has polar ice caps made mostly of frozen water. And there are lots of bits on the surface of Mars that look like they were created by moving water a long time ago. It is the only planet that we've landed robotic rovers on, and the only planet that we've flown a helicopter on other than Earth. Jupiter is the fifth planet from the Sun and the largest planet in the solar system. It is more massive than all the other planets in the solar system, and in fact every other planet will fit inside of it. One of Jupiter's most famous features is its great red spot. This is a giant storm that has been going on for at least 150 years. The great red spot is around twice the size of the Earth. Saturn is the second largest planet in the solar system, and like Jupiter, is a gas planet. This means it does not have a solid surface. While Saturn is not the only planet with rings in the solar system, they are the brightest and biggest. The rings of Saturn are not solid, but are made from millions of pieces of ice and rock. The rings are around 1 kilometer thick and 2,500 kilometers wide. Uranus, the seventh planet from the Sun, and the third biggest planet by diameter in the solar system. Neptune is heavier because it's denser. Uranus is an ice giant, made of slushy liquid and ice, with a small rocky core. Like Saturn, Uranus has rings, but they are much fainter. Uranus is an unusual planet because its equator is tilted by 90 degrees compared to its orbit. It makes it look like it's spinning on its side. It is the only planet that we know of that does this. Neptune is the furthest planet from the Sun, about 30 times further away than the Earth. It is mostly made of water, methane, and ammonia ice, with a small rocky core. The average temperature on Neptune is minus 200 Celsius. Because it is so far away, it is the only planet that we cannot see from the Earth without using a telescope. It has the fastest known wind speeds of any planet, with speeds up to 2,000 kilometers an hour. Before we saw Neptune, astronomers noticed Uranus had a strange orbit, so we used maths to predict where the planet should be. And later, in 1846, it was discovered.
Thanks, David. I know a lot more about the planets of our solar system now. And did you spot any presence in the solar system? If you did, write down how many you spotted in box number one on your map. So our solar system contains 8 planets and lots of smaller objects like moons, dwarf planets, asteroids and comets. And they're all about 4,500 million years old. And in the centre of our solar system is the Sun. And the planets all orbit around the Sun because of its gravity. Did you know the Sun is a star? On a nice night, you can see hundreds of stars in the sky, but space actually contains thousands of millions of them. Stars are made when huge clouds of gas and dust clump together and the stuff inside gets squeezed and squeezed and squeezed until it's hot enough for a star to start shining. So a star is a huge sphere of super hot gas. They shine because of something called nuclear fusion. That's what powers a star. And when I say hot, I mean really hot. Even the cool ones are over 4,000 degrees. And when I say huge, I mean huge. You could fit a million planet Earths in the Sun. And in the biggest star we know of, you could fit more than 3,000 million suns inside that. If that huge star replaced our Sun in the solar system, it's so big the edges would stretch past Mercury, past Venus, past Earth, and even past Jupiter. But what makes the Sun so special to us? I think my friend Stacey at the North Pole can help us. What do we know about the Sun and other stars, Stacey?
Okay, so what we know is that the Earth is in a system with the Sun and the Sun is a star. So what makes the Sun special from any other star? Only that it's close to us here on Earth. So every year, it takes us a full year to orbit once around the Sun. And as the Earth goes around the Sun, because we are slightly tilted over to one side, we have times when we're slightly closer to the Sun and times when we're slightly further away, and that gives us the seasons. So every year on Earth, we'll go through the full range of seasons. Certainly here, in as far north as we are, we'll experience winter, autumn, spring, summer, go back again. So the changes are just because when we're facing the Sun, when the northern hemisphere is facing the Sun, it gets hotter for longer, we have longer days, there's more time for the Sun to shine on Earth. And when we're facing away during the autumn and winter, there's less sunlight hitting the Earth, so it's colder and we have shorter days. So we know that the Sun is special because we are going around it, and that's basically all that's special about it. And as we orbit around the Sun, we're not just orbiting, we're spinning. So every 24 hours, the Earth spins around on its axis. And when we spin and we face the Sun, we experience daytime. And when we spin and face away from the Sun, we experience nighttime. So the Earth is constantly doing this pirouette whilst it's traveling around the Sun. And what we see as we're turning is the Sun rising, moving across the sky, and then setting. The Sun doesn't actually move at all, it's just because of us spinning around. So every day we'll spin around on our axis, we'll see the Sun rise and the Sun set. Okay, so we said that we spin around, we see the Sun rise and the Sun set. Strange thing about here in the North Pole is that during the winter we barely see the Sun rise at all. We're so far north, here up in Lapland with Santa Claus, that the Sun barely makes its way over the horizon in the winter before it sets again. So we get some really long nights. It does mean that we see some pretty quirky things. And one of the things that we get to see almost every winter is something called the Northern Lights, or the Aurora Borealis. And that's when particles from the Sun, tiny little pieces of the Sun, fall towards the Earth. And because the Earth has got a magnetic field, it's got a giant magnet, you can think of it like a bar magnet going through the middle of the Earth, all of those particles which have a charge on them get filtered in to the North and the South Pole. So here, where Santa lives, we get a pretty good view of this all winter long because the nights are so long and we get so many of these particles coming in. The other thing that we of course get is some pretty amazing views of the night sky. We get to see it an awful lot at this time of year. And the night sky is full of stars. Stars like our Sun, the only difference being that they are much, much further away. So stars all work the same, but they don't all look the same. Our Sun, obviously during the day, is so bright and so dominant, we don't see any other stars around. But as soon as it's nighttime, we're seeing things much, much further away, and that's all that the stars you see are. Other suns, but a lot further away from us here on Earth. So all stars are like the Sun, but not all stars are the same. So what are the differences that we see between different stars? Well, if you look really closely in the night sky, you see that not all stars are the same colour. We actually see some stars that appear quite red. And when we're thinking about things in space, red actually means cold. So the stars that we see that are quite red are quite cold. We also see stars that are quite blue. And the blue stars are hot stars. And then we see stars that kind of have a colour in the middle, like yellow ones, just like our Sun. So we see different colours between all the stars, but what else do we see? Well, we also see stars that are different brightnesses. Some stars appear much brighter than the stars in the background. And the question is why? Sometimes the stars are really bright because they're actually really close to us here on Earth. So it could be one of our closest neighbour stars. Sometimes they're so bright just because they are so big. So in astronomy, we try and find out how far away these stars are so we can work out if they're bright just because they're nearby or because they're actually really massive stars. So stars all have different colours, different temperatures and different sizes, but they all have the same thing in common, which is how they're powered. The other thing when we look at the night sky is that there are so many stars, we can start to see patterns in them. And people have done this for centuries and centuries, looking at patterns in the sky. So the different kind of patterns people see can vary depending on where we are around the world. So I might see a rabbit here with the stars. I might look at a different patch of the sky and I might start to see a bear. But if I was from a country that didn't have rabbits or bears, it might be that I'd figured out a different pattern to the stars in the sky, and the bear might actually be some kind of chameleon. So different cultures around the world have different histories in looking at the stars and the patterns in them. And we call these patterns in the stars constellations. And we're going to have a go now at making our own. Over to you, Jenny.
Thanks, Stacey. Did you spot any presents while Stacey was telling us all about stars? If you did, write them down on your map. Yes, we're going to have a go at making some constellations now all together. So every evening, the sun sets because the Earth's turning around. And as the sun sets, you might spot a planet or two if you're lucky, but you'll definitely see lots and lots of stars. And for thousands of years, people have looked at the stars and imagined people or animals, characters from their stories in them. It's like the stars are a big dot to dot, and people just draw imaginary lines to make these pictures. You might already know about some of these pictures. One you might be familiar with is a bit further around to the north, or further around to the north, yep, above that building there. It looks a bit like a question mark, or maybe a bit like a saucepan. Can you see that shape there? That's the plow, or the Big Dipper, and that's part of the constellation called Ursa Major. And people thought that those stars looked like a great bear, so Ursa Major means great bear. There's the bear that people imagined in the sky. So next time it's dark, have a look out for that saucepan shape. You can see it all year round. Another constellation that's good to spot in the winter time is a bit further around to the east. You'll see it by spotting three bright stars in a row. Can you see those three stars? That's Orion's Belt, part of the constellation of Orion the Hunter. So do look out for some of these constellations in the sky next time you see some stars. But for now, we're going to have a go at making our own constellation. So you're going to need maybe some paper and something to write with. So if your teachers are ready, they can get some materials ready for you now and you can have a go along with us. If not, don't worry. You can always have a go later. Doesn't matter if you haven't got everything ready now. Just watch what I'm doing and then have a go later. So you'll need maybe some paper and star stickers, or you can use crayons to draw your stars. It doesn't matter. But I'd recommend a pencil as well to sketch out the shape of what your constellation will be. Because you need to decide stars, whether they're stickers or crayons. Think about whether it's maybe going to be your favourite animal, or maybe your favorite pop star, your favorite toy, your favorite comic hero or sports star. But the key thing is you can only use 10 stars to make your constellation. No more than 10. That's the challenge. How can you recreate a shape using only 10 stars? So have a think about what you're going to make, and your teachers may be handing out some paper and pencils or some star stickers. I'm going to recreate one of my favourite constellations. It's called Canis Major. It's a great dog. It's known as Orion's hunting dog. So I'm going to try and make the shape of a dog using only 10 stars. Have you all had a think about what you're going to make, either now or later on? If you're going to have a go at this later, you can maybe make a dog like me, or a cat, or as I said, one of your favourite celebrities or favourite toys. It doesn't matter. But if you're going to have a go now, get ready, because we're only going to have 2 minutes to do this. So I've got my materials. I'm just going to count my stars again just to make sure I haven't got more than 10. No cheating for me. So I've got my 10 stars. I'm going to sketch out the shape of my dog to start with to make it a bit easier. So my dog needs a body, and it needs a tail to wag. It needs a head, and it definitely needs some legs, because Canis Major, Orion's dog, was said to be the fastest hunting dog in the world. So it definitely needs some legs so it can run fast. There we are, got my four legs. So I've got my shape. How are you getting on? Maybe you've got a sketch of a person or an animal. Now I need to start putting my stars on, working out where to put them. Going to put one on the chest of the dog and then one at the other end on its back. Did you know the star on Canis Major's chest is called Sirius? It's the brightest star in the sky, and it's who Sirius Black in Harry Potter was named after. So I've got my two stars for my dog's body. I'm going to add some stars for the back legs now and front legs. And for the dog's tail. So I haven't got many stars left. I've just got three left. So they'll have to be the dog's head and include the ears and nose and mouth and everything. There we go. There's my constellation. Do you think it looks like a dog? I think it does. How are you getting on? We're coming up towards the end of this section. So if you haven't finished, don't worry. You can carry on later. And if you're going to have a go at your own later, that's fine as well. We also had to think about some other ways you could make constellations. We came up with a Christmassy idea for how to make some that could shine. I got some black paper and poked some holes in it. And then I stuck some battery powered fairy lights to the back of it. So I made a smiley face shape by poking holes in the paper. And then when I turn on the lights, it shines like the stars do. So if you have any ideas for how to make constellations, maybe over the holidays, share them with your teacher and they can take some photos and share them with us at the National Schools Observatory. If you want to share any photos of your constellations, you can find us on social media or you can email the NSO at lgmu.ac.uk. Right. Well done, everybody, for making some constellations. I think we're going to learn more about stars now. I'm going to hand over to my friend Andy to learn about what happens when lots and lots of stars come together.
That was great. Thanks very much for that. So you've all just been making some nice constellations, and I hope you've got some good ones to share with each other. But I think it's time to climb back onto the sleigh and we can fly out to explore the Milky Way, which is what we're going to do next. Now, you've seen that there are lots and lots of stars in the sky, some of them making patterns that we call constellations, but there are many more stars that are too far away for us to see without telescopes, enough to make billions of constellations if we could see them all. And these stars all make a big swirling cloud like the drawing here, the Milky Way. And our sun is just one star among all those billions, and it's about here in the Milky Way. And when you get billions of stars all together like this, we call it a galaxy. So the Milky Way is a galaxy, and because of its shape, that nice swirling shape, we call it a spiral galaxy. But there are lots of other galaxies as well. So now it's time to explore galaxies a little bit. Now, some galaxies are spiral galaxies like our Milky Way, and there are pictures of two here. We've got one called Andromeda and one called the Whirlpool Galaxy. Now, Andromeda, the one on the left, is the nearest big galaxy to us. It's kind of like our next door neighbour. And the Whirlpool is a bit further away. And you can probably see it's actually made of two galaxies. There's a big spiral one, but there's another smaller one at the top. And that smaller one is slowly falling into the bigger spiral galaxy. And in a few billion years, they'll probably be joined together in a single, slightly bigger galaxy. But not all galaxies are spiral ones like these. Others are smoother and they're sort of orangey clouds of stars. And we call those elliptical galaxies, like this one. But all galaxies, no matter what they look like, are full of stars, hundreds of billions of stars. And those stars probably have planets going around them. Planets a bit like the Earth or Mars or Jupiter. Maybe there are even aliens on some of those planets in faraway galaxies with giant telescopes. Should we just have a wave? And just in case they're looking at us now, should we all wave? There we go. Say hello to the aliens. Yay, that's great. Now, as well as stars and planets and things like that, we think in the middle of all of these galaxies, there are probably really big black holes, things that we call supermassive black holes. Now, black holes are made when stars that are much bigger than the sun, stop making energy and they stop shining and they suddenly collapse. And they can end up squeezed so small that the gravity on them is much, much stronger. So strong that not even light can get away. So if you were somehow able to stand on one of these squeezed stars, a bit weird, but if you were able to stand on one of these squeezed stars and you had a torch and you shone it straight up in the air, the light would bend over and land on your feet. And because light can't escape from a black hole, black holes are invisible. That's how they get their name. And if light can't escape, nor can anything else. So anything that gets too close to a black hole, even another black hole, will be sucked in by the gravity and will never come out again, making the black hole bigger and bigger. Unless you're really close, though, you won't get sucked in. So you and me and Santa and the elves are all safe. All the black holes are too far away to suck us in. But we think that is how the really big black holes in the middle of galaxies are made. A small black hole sucks in other black holes and stars and gas and things like that that get too close, and it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. So you can see that galaxies are very big and exciting, and they've got black holes and stars and planets and a lot more. Now, that's quite a lot to take in and understand, isn't it? So I think it will help to get our brains working if we stretch our bodies a little bit. So it's time to pass over to Emma for a little bit of space yoga.
Wow, space is full of so many amazing things. My mind is absolutely buzzing with information, and we're only halfway through our adventure. So I'd like to take a minute just to get calm, get prepared and get all warmed up for our next leg. Something that I like to do to focus my mind but also keep my body warmed up is yoga. So let's see if we can do some cosmic yoga. First of all, let's take a few deep breaths. So breathe in through your nose, nice and deep, and then take a big deep breath out through your mouth. We can do that a few more times. So in through the nose, big deep breath out through your mouth. We can bring our shoulders into it too. So as we breathe in through our nose, bring your shoulders up to your ears. And then one last big deep breath out and bring your shoulders down nice and relaxed. Brilliant. My mind can't stop thinking about all the amazing things we've already seen on our journey. So we've seen things like stars. We've seen our very own star, our sun. So let's see if we can use our bodies to make the shape of our very own star, the sun. First of all, bring your hands out to your sides with your palms facing up. Nice and relaxed so your shoulders are away from your ears. And breathe in. And as you breathe in, raise your arms up above your head and bend your elbows so that your fingertips touch above your head and make the nice big shape of the sun. And then as we breathe out, we can bring our arms back down to our sides. Brilliant. Now let's do that a few more times. So breathe in. Bring your arms up above your head. Nice big shape of the sun. Look up and imagine the sun's sunshine energy shining on your face. And then as you bring your arms down, breathe out. Nice and slow. So we'll do it two more times. So arms up and breathe in. And arms down. Breathe out, and one more time, arms up, breathing in, and arms out, breathing out. Brilliant, let your arms down by your side, nice and relaxed, and give them a little wiggle. You might feel them nice and warm, just like the sun's energy is warming them. Well done. We also visited the moon. One of my favourite phases of the moon are the crescent phases. So let's see if we can use our bodies to make the shape of the crescent moons. So if you bring our arms out to our side again, with our palms facing up, and this time we're going to bring our arms all the way up above our heads, keeping our arms straight at the elbows so that we're pointing straight up with our hands. Now, what we want to do is lean over to the right, just nice and gently, don't pull yourself, and we can make the shape of the crescent moon. Now remember, for each phase of the moon, there's two crescent shapes. So we're going to come back into the middle, and we're going to bend over to our left and make the shape of the other crescent moon. So that's it. Let's try that a few more times. We can use our breath as well. So breathe in as we come to the top and reach up, and then breathe out as you bend over to the right. And breathe in as you come to the top, and breathe out as you come over to the left. That's great. Everyone looks like crescent moons. One more time. Into the center, breathe out and over to the left. And then big deep breath in as we come to the top, and breathe out as you bring your arms all down by the side and relax your arms, give them a nice little shake out. We've also visited galaxies, and we visited one called the Milky Way, which is our very own galaxy, and that galaxy is a spiral galaxy. So let's use our arms to see if we can make the shape of a spiral galaxy. So we're going to bring our arms out to the sides, and we're going to have our left palm facing down and our right palm facing up. And then we're going to bring our right arm above our head and bend at the elbow so that our palm, our right palm, is facing down just above our heads. And we're going to bring our left arm, bend at the elbow, and bring it to the bottom of our belly with our palms facing up. There we go. Now, nice and slowly, we're going to stretch our arms out to the side and switch them over like this. So arms out to the side, left palm facing up, right palm facing down, and then switch them so that our left hand's above our head facing down and our right hand is by our belly facing up. And then we're going to switch them again, nice and smooth. There we go. So our arms were like a spiral galaxy. And we can start to use our breath as well. So we can breathe in as our left arm comes up, and then breathe out again as it comes down. So we'll do that two more times. Breathe in and switch our arms over, and breathe out, switch our arms over again. Great work, everyone. One of my other favourite galaxies are elliptical galaxies, and they are some of the oldest galaxies in the whole universe, and some of them can be absolutely massive, like Cygnus A. So let's stretch our arms out and imagine we are a big elliptical galaxy. That's this shaped galaxy, big fat circle. So hold your arms out. There we go. You can have your palms facing any way that feels comfortable. Now, Cygnus A has something in the middle of it which is incredibly special. It's a supermassive black hole, and black holes can pull in matter from all around them. So let's pull our arms in together and bring our heads down and ball up like we're a black hole sucking matter in from Cygnus A. Now let's stretch back out again, like Cygnus A, that big elliptical galaxy, and bring your arms in and your head in again, like the supermassive black hole. And then stretch out again, like Cygnus A, and we'll do it one more time. We can breathe in while we're the big supermassive black hole, and then breathe out like you'll be in a huge elliptical galaxy. Good work, everyone. So lower your arms down to your sides, give your arms a nice shake off, and a big deep breath in, and one supermassive deep breath out. Well done, everyone. You've made some truly cosmic yoga shapes, and I now feel really ready and calm for the next leg of our adventure.
Okay, everyone, so I hope you're feeling nice and stretched out and feeling ready for the next leg of our adventure, and are sitting still again so that we can pay lots of attention. So my friend Vika is about to explain how galaxies fit into the structure of the universe. So remember to pay attention and watch out for the presence. Over to Vika.
So we've just learned what a galaxy is. But you know, galaxies, we don't like to be alone. We like to be among our friends, our galaxies. And together, we all combine in galaxy clusters. So for example, if you look at the sky with Hubble Space Telescope, you will see that galaxies, you know, they kind of try to stick together. And you see some more clustered areas and some areas with more empty space. You can see it better in this picture. So this is the result of a computer simulation, and the tiny bright orange-yellow dots are galaxies. And if you look at the bottom picture, you see that they conglomerate all together to form these galaxy clusters. And these galaxy clusters, they also tend to be next to whom? To another galaxy clusters. So they conglomerate a huge, huge, big cluster. And if you slightly zoom out, you see that this galaxy cluster surrounded by thin lines. And if you zoom out more and more and more, you will see the whole large-scale structure of our universe. You will see very clustered parts and very empty parts. How does it look like for you? We, a cosmologist, call it spider web. But I personally don't like spiders. So I will show you another example how it looks like. A pancake. And today we will see how to create a universe in a pancake on your own kitchen. But guys, safety rules, please ask an adult to help you to do this. Do not do this yourself. So first of all, we need an ingredient. In the beginning, our universe had a lot of different particles with a lot of different ingredients. And for example, we can use a cup of milk as our dark energy and a glass of flour as our dark matter. And you'll learn soon what it is. And also we need other particles, very small ones. So we can use an egg, oil, and a bit of sugar. And what do we do? Our universe in the beginning was very, very hot and very, very mixed. So we pull all these particles together in a pot and mix it really, really well. And then, because the universe was very hot, we put it in a hot pan. And this, what we see? We see a bit of a structure already. But our universe was evolving for billion and billion years. And during this evolution, the structure popped up. So if you will look on our pancake, you see there are some holes, there are some more cluster areas, but are kind of some areas are a bit more cooked, some are a bit undercooked. So you see, this is the structure. And absolutely the same happened in our universe. During all these years of evolution and cooking, we get the structure. So now you can see how our galaxies looks exactly the same as the clumps in our pancakes. And this is how you can create a universe in your own kitchen in a pancake.
Thanks, Vika. Wow, I didn't know there were so many galaxies in the universe, or that the universe was all clumpy. Plus, I now know what I'm having for my tea tonight. I hope you've been spotting the presents that were there in the galaxies and in the universe. But we're sticking with the universe, so don't put your answer in the box just yet. We're going to learn some more about the universe, because I saw that Vika had some special ingredients, dark matter and dark energy. But what is dark matter? And what is dark energy? I think my friend Ricardo can tell us. So, Ricardo, what's the universe made of?
Hi. Now we are going to talk about what this huge universe that we live in is made of. We've been discussing things such as planets and stars and galaxies, right? Those are things that are made of atoms and molecules, right? So these are things that we can see. Astronomers, scientists have a specific name, a funny name for these things. They are called baryons, right? So things that we have everyday experience with, like the oxygen that we breathe, the calcium in our bones, right? These are baryons. So as it happens, the universe has a lot more to it than meets the eye. So the baryons actually make a very small part of what the universe is. So if we imagine that the universe is like a pie that weighs 100 grams, the baryons, like they would be a slice that weighs only 5 grams. So a tiny part of what the universe is made of is baryons. All the rest is something else. Basically, two different things make up the rest of the content of the universe. The first one is what we call dark matter. Dark matter would be a slice that is 25 grams, and so roughly a quarter of what the universe is made of is dark matter. Dark matter has this interesting property, right? We cannot see it, call it dark, but it has gravity. It means that it can bring things together, it pulls things together, right? like on the Earth, like we have gravity, so that things fall on the floor. So dark matter attracts things. But interesting fact, we don't know what dark matter is, right? We know it's a particle, but we don't know which particle it is. We have never detected that particle. Interesting, huh? So now, how about the rest of the universe, the remaining almost two-thirds, more than two-thirds of the universe, 70 grams lies there. What would that be? We call that dark energy. Ha, what a cool name, dark energy. Right, so what is dark energy? Dark energy is this substance, this material that has an opposite property to that of dark matter. While dark matter brings things together, pulls things together, dark energy pushes them apart, okay? So dark energy is actually responsible for our universe to be expanding faster and faster with time. So, right? And I have news for you. We don't know what dark energy is either. Ha, how interesting. So now, an interesting thing to think about is the following. Dark matter. Dark matter, as I said, brings things together, pulls things together, right? Because of gravity. Now, dark matter is responsible for galaxies to form, right? Because baryons alone would not be able, they don't have enough gravity, right? To bring galaxies together. You need dark matter to do that, right? So, without dark matter, galaxies would never have been formed. And now, think about this. Without galaxies, there are no stars. There would be no stars. Stars can only be formed within galaxies. And guess what? Without stars, there will be no planets. Without planets, there will be no us. So, the conclusion is that without dark matter, we would not exist. Okay, so we owe our existence to something we don't even know what is, dark matter. Our Milky Way, our galaxy, is actually surrounded by a halo of dark matter that is what keeps it together. Without the dark matter, the stars would just fly apart from each other and the galaxy wouldn't be here. Interesting, huh? Now, let's think about this a little more. Like, out of 100 gram pi, only 5% is stuff that we know what is. The remaining 95 grams of that pi is stuff that we don't know, right? Dark matter and dark energy. Astronomers have been working on the universe, or on learning about the universe for centuries, right? And we still don't know what dark matter and dark energy are. But think about this, 100 years ago, astronomers thought that the universe was made only of the things we can see. So we learned a lot. We learned that there's a lot more to the universe than we thought before. We learned that the universe consists of a bunch of things, lots of things that we still have to discover. And this is fascinating. This is, right? So because we still have a lot to learn about the universe. Now, scientists, right? The first thing that you think when I mention a scientist is, oh, a scientist is a person who knows a lot about a lot of stuff, isn't it? That's the what people usually think. And I'm telling you here that the scientists don't know what 95% of the universe is made of. The important thing to consider here is not that the scientists should know about everything, because we don't ever know about everything. Scientists are the people who want to know about everything and dedicate their lives to knowing more, to learning more. And how would they do that? They do that by asking questions. So, by all means, every time you want to learn about something, you want to ask a scientist, they will know about stuff like the oceans, the climate, viruses, the stars, right? They are very knowledgeable about these things, but most importantly, they will be always wanting to know more about those things and learn about what they don't know. So asking questions is very important, and you should always be asking questions about everything because it's the best way to learn about the world that surrounds you. And so maybe it's a good idea to start asking those questions about the universe. And sometimes, someday, perhaps you may be able to help us figuring out what dark matter is and what dark energy is and what is our place in this beautiful universe that we live.
Wow, that was fantastic, Ricardo. So much stuff out there that we've got to ask questions about. I love asking questions. I think that's probably why I ended up as a scientist, because I love doing that. Well, we did it. Welcome back to the Earth. We've gone all the way around and we've looked at planets and we've looked at stars and constellations and the Milky Way and galaxies and then the whole universe. And we've made it all the way back to the Earth. And so now we've got to see whether we found all of the presents. And so what I want you to do is go around and make a little note of all of the numbers that you've written on your map to see if you found all of the presents. And then we'll go through the map one by one and see if we can find them. So remember, we're looking for planets in the we're looking for presents in the solar system, and we're looking for presents that you found near the stars and near the Milky Way and around the galaxies and out in the whole universe. So I'm just going to go through each of those one by one, and you're going to call out how many presents you think you found there. And when we've called them all out, we'll go through and see if you've got the right number. So how many presents did you find in the solar system? Oh, quite a few people found presents there. That's great. What about presents in the stars? Oh, quite a few there as well. That's good. And how about presents in the Milky Way? Oh, not quite so many of them, I don't think. Oh, maybe we didn't have as many presents in the Milky Way. We'll find out in a minute. What about presents out among the galaxies? Oh, yeah, lots of people found presents in the galaxies. And finally, what about presents out in the whole universe? Did you find presents out in the whole universe? Shout out how many you found. Oh, excellent. You've all found lots and lots of presents. So let's see if you've got the right number, shall we? So let's see how many presents there were in each place. See if we can bring up the numbers. Well, in the solar system, you should have found 6 presents. So if you found 6 presents, give yourselves a big round of applause. If you didn't quite find all 6, you still found some. So that's pretty good. What about stars? Well, there should have been 5 presents around the stars. So if you found 5, well done. We've got all those back as well. That's brilliant. And what about the Milky Way? Well, there was only 1 present in the Milky Way. But if you found that 1 present, that's really good, because we'll bring that one back. And galaxies, there were only 2. But again, if you found those 2, they'll be really useful and somebody will really like those. And finally, looking out in the universe, there were 7 presents. And so if you found all of those presents and brought them back, we've got all the presents we need. And even if you didn't find them all, somebody will have done. So somebody will have helped the elves find all of the presents. We've got them all back. And Santa can now hand out those presents properly on Christmas Eve to all the people who want their presents in and will have something to open on Christmas Day, which is always very exciting. So that was our tour of the universe. But as Ricardo said, it's very important that you have that you ask lots of questions. So we get some questions sent in before we started this, and we're going to see if we can answer some of those questions now. And I've got some of the team to come along and help answer those questions. And the first question, I think, is about black holes. Yes. So the first question is, how do we know when a black hole starts? And what would happen if our solar system got too close to one? And I think the best person to answer that one is probably Chris. So, Chris, do you want to answer that question?
Thank you, Andy. Yes, what a fantastic question. Question about the black hole. I'm sure many of you would have listened to Andy earlier about black holes. And we start by just saying that we form a black hole when a very large star, probably 10 times more massive than the sun, collapses. And nothing can escape from the black hole. Gravity is so strong. The best way of forming a black hole, therefore, is through a stellar explosion. But probably the best place to find a black hole is at the center of our galaxy, the center of the Milky Way, where we believe there's a black hole of probably 1 million solar masses, something like that. But of course, it's important not to get too close to a black hole. We don't want any of Santa's presents to be falling into the black hole, because the elves won't be able to receive them. Remember, nothing escapes from the black hole. if a black hole was to come towards the solar system, then at first we wouldn't notice very much, but after a while we'd be pulled towards the black hole. And eventually the gravitational pull would be so strong that if we went into the black hole feet first, then our feet would be stretched very, very far away from our head and we'd end up like spaghetti. It's called spaghettification because the gravitational pull would stretch us into a very long piece of material. So don't go near a black hole. And finally, I'll just say that a few years ago, we found a direct evidence of black holes because two black holes collided. And when black holes collide, they shake the universe. And the Earth was shaken in 2017. Don't worry, you wouldn't have fallen off your chairs. It was a very small shake. But that shake was detected, and so we now know that black holes really do exist. So excellent question. Thank you, Andy.
That was a very good question, wasn't it? I like black holes. Black holes are absolutely awesome. Time for another question, I think. And the question here is about planets. So how are planets made and how do they grow? And I think, Jenny, you're our planet expert. Do you want to answer that one?
Yeah, I can answer that one. So the planets of our solar system, they started from a huge cloud of dust and gas about 4,500 million years ago. So most of that cloud of gas and dust became the sun, but some of the dust and gas was left over in a sort of flat disk, a bit like a pancake shaped around the sun. And forces like gravity inside the disk cause stuff in the cloud to bump into each other and start to stick together. So these dust balls clump together to form pebble-sized pieces, and the gas around them help these rocky pieces stick together to form larger pieces, sort of kilometres wide. These, we call these planetesimals, these sort of planets that are going to form. They orbited around the sun, sweeping up more and more dust and gas. It's a bit like if you're rolling a snowball, how it gets bigger and bigger. So that's how the rocky planets formed over millions of years. The further you get from the sun, the colder it is. So their ice can freeze and you get ice added in with the gas and dust. And it's also cold enough for the planets to hold on to lots more gas. So that's how the gas and ice giants formed. We think it took about 10 million years. So do planets grow? Well, they did grow to start with in the very early solar system from all this dust and gas sticking together. But once they were fully grown, we think they've stayed pretty much the same size for the last 4 billion years or so. But planets can change. We think Mars and Venus's climates have changed a lot, and Earth's climate is changing too. So planets did grow from very small pieces, but once they got to the size they are, they stay at that size. Back to you, Andy.
That's great. Thank you. Yes, I'm quite glad that planets aren't growing. I don't think I'd want the Earth to get any bigger. I quite like it as it is. It's about the right size. I think it's time for another question. What is our next question, do we think? Ooh, how do we know that rain on Venus is acid? That sounds very nasty. Do you want to tell us about the acid rain on Venus, Emma?
Brilliant question. Thank you very much, Andy. Be very pleased to help answer that. So we know certainly that Venus has sulfuric acid clouds, and we have a few ways to detect these. One way is to use light that's reflected from the atmosphere of Venus to understand the different substances and chemicals that make up its atmosphere. So we understand that some of those clouds in the atmosphere are certainly made of sulfuric acid. And we've also confirmed those findings using probes that have dropped into Venus's thick clouds, and they also have detectors on them that can confirm what we see. And some probes have also landed on the surface of Venus, but they have only lasted about 2 minutes before being dissolved by the acid in the clouds that they've passed through. So when we think about rain and how we know that the rain on Venus is acid, we think that if it does rain acid, it actually boils off before it reaches the surface because it's so hot on Venus, 475 degrees Celsius on the surface. So if you were actually stood on the surface of Venus, even if it was raining acid, it wouldn't actually reach you because it would evaporate off so quickly. So yeah, I hope that answers your question. Thank you very much for that, Andy, and for the question.
That's brilliant. I'm glad we don't have a brain like that on the Earth, definitely. I think Venus would be an amazing place to look at from a distance, but you wouldn't want to go there. I think we've got time for another question as well. What's the next question? Do we have people? I think we got a little bit stuck. Oh, there we go. Oh, what are the dwarf planets and why is there a Kuiper belt in space? Now, I like dwarf planets, so I'm going to ask her this question. When we first started discovering planets, we found that there were two kinds of planets. There's ones made of rock like the Earth and Mars and Venus and Mercury. And then there's the bigger ones made of gas and ice like Jupiter and Neptune and so on. And then we discovered there was another one even further out called Pluto. And we thought, oh, good, another planet. That's great. But soon we found that there were other ones that are a bit like Pluto as well, but they're also quite small. Pluto's much smaller than the Earth. It's smaller even than the Moon. And so we began to think that, well, if there's a lot of these little ones, do we want to have them all lumped together with the planets like the Earth and Mars? Or do we want to give them their own special name? Do we want to get all of these smaller planets and group them together and call them dwarf planets so that we can try and understand them properly? So dwarf planets are things which are a bit too small to be a planet like the Earth, but they're a bit too big to just be a rock in space like an asteroid. And we think that a lot of these, not just a few, but thousands and thousands of these dwarf planets might be out in a thing called the Kuiper Belt, which is a big sort of disk cloud of planets and rocks and dwarf planets and rocks out way beyond where Pluto is. And we think that was made when the solar system was being formed. As Jenny told you about the planets, in near the middle of the solar system, there was lots of stuff to stick together into big planets. But further out, it was all a bit more spread out and it didn't stick together quite so easily into big things. And so lots and lots and lots of smaller things are made. And some smaller things that were made near the middle got thrown out when they got too close to another planet. And a lot of those ended up in the Kuiper Belt. And so it's what's left over after we've made all the big planets. And that's what we think the Kuiper Belt is. And that's why we think there is one. And it's quite likely that out there, where there are other planets going around other stars, quite likely that those other stars have a thing a bit like the Kuiper Belt as well, with their own dwarf planets. But it'll be a very long time before we have telescopes big enough to find those, I think. Very good question. Thank you for that. I think that's probably all the questions we've got time for at the moment. What we'll try and do for some of the questions that you've asked us today and some of the questions you sent in, we'll try and answer those questions on the website at some point fairly soon. But they were really good questions. And like all the best scientists, you're asking the good questions. Now you can go away and try and find out the answers. But we've pretty nearly run out of time now. We've traveled all the way around the universe and we found presents that the elves have brought back to Santa so that he can go and deliver them all on Christmas Eve. So it's really time to come to the end and to say thank you to everybody for taking part and for making this happen. And I particularly want to thank all of the NSO team, especially Ali, Jenny, Stacey and Emma, who you can see here. And all the astronomers who helped to guide you through the universe. So that's Chris and David and Ricardo and Vika. But I also want to thank all the teachers and parents and helpers who've made this happen out there. And for all the teachers, remember to look out for an email that should be coming soon so you can get your certificate of participation for all your pupils. But most of all, I want to thank all of you for coming along and helping Santa and his elves and exploring the universe with us. So thank you all very much and give yourselves a very big round of applause.